Hi everyone, welcome back to my YouTube videos. In this video, I'm going to start with a new playlist. This one is going to be about undergrad level probability theory. So in particular, that's going to be much easier than the previous videos I recorded, and you don't need to be a PhD student in mathematics to understand what I'm going to do in this playlist. In fact, many of the problems I'm going to do are even accessible at the high school level, I would say. So all the playlist is going to be organized around this book. That's a first course in probability theory by Sheldon Ross. That's the book I'm using to teach undergrad level probability theory. I believe that's also one of the most popular books in the topic. So most of the videos will be about practice problems from that book. I will only record a few videos about the theory. That's very light for the theory. For the theory, I will also follow the material of that book, but following the approach of my own book called Stochastic Modeling. So that's for the theoretical part. I will use my own book, but all the practice problems will be from Ross's book. So this first video is about combinatorial analysis. I'm going to tell you about things that we call arrangement, permutation, and combination. And combinatorial analysis, or combinatorics also, is a branch of mathematics that deals with all the counting principles. And so before we get started with that, I want to motivate a little bit, like explain the reason why we start with combinatorial analysis. Even if it's not strictly speaking about probability theory, combinatorial analysis is important to understand in general probability problems. So for instance, let's assume that you have two fair dice. You roll the two dice and you want to compute the probability that you get a sum equal to 7, for instance. So in this case, the way you deal with the problem, even if you don't know anything about probability, you can guess that the probability of having a sum equal to 7 is going to be exactly the total number of outcomes that gives you a 7 divided by the total number of outcomes if you roll the two dice. So let's solve this problem. And you see that here you can just count on your fingers because you have 6 possible outcomes for each of the two dice. That gives you a total of 6 squared equals 36 possible outcomes for the two dice. Now, if you look at the total number of outcomes such that the sum is equal to 7, you would get exactly 6 possible outcomes. You can get 1-6 or 6-1, 2-5-5-2, 3-4-4-3. That's all the possible ways the two dice are going to land on a sum equal to 7. So that gives you a probability 6 over 36 equals 1/6 of getting a sum equal to 7 if you roll two fair dice. So you see that in this case, the problem is pretty simple and we don't really need any specific tools from mathematics to be able to compute the probability of having a 7. You can just count on your fingers. But let's assume now that you play poker, meaning that you take 5 cards from a deck of 52 cards and you want to find the probability that you get a full house. So in this case, again, assuming that the deck of 52 cards is well mixed, all the possible poker hands are going to be equally likely. And again, the probability of having a full house is reduced to a counting problem. You want to find the total number of possible full houses and you divide this number by the total possible number of poker hands. So that shows you the connection between probability theory and combinatorial analysis. But you see that if instead of looking at the dice problem, you now look at the poker primes and poker probabilities, you see that counting becomes much more difficult. You cannot just count on your fingers, and we indeed need more sophisticated tools to be able to compute those probabilities. So the three most common counting rules are called arrangement, permutation, and combination. Each of the three can occur with or without repetition, which gives you 6 possible counting rules. And the goal of this video is going to be to compute explicitly the total number of possible arrangement permutation or combination with or without repetition. So we are going to end up with six formula. So the case of arrangement consists in choosing a subset of a given set and order the elements of this subset. The case of permutation consists in just ordering the elements of a given set, while the case of combination consists in choosing a subset of a given set. So let's start with the case of arrangement with repetition. That's the simplest of the six possible continuous rules. In this case, the problem is mathematically the same as counting the total number of possible orderings of k blocks, and each of these blocks can be of n different colors, and we allow repetition of the same color. So in this case, I rewrote the statement here. Look at number of possible orderings of k blocks. We have n colors for each block. Then that clearly gives you n possibilities for the first block, because you have n possible colors. So that's the first step. So you start with an n. That's the total number of possible choices for the first block. But because we allow repetition of the colors, for the second block, we again have n possibilities, n possible colors, so it's n times n, and so on, and you do this k times. So eventually, you can simplify this expression and you get n at the power k. So conclusion, the total number of possible orderings of k blocks, each of which can be of n different colors, is equal to n at the power k, and that corresponds to the total number of possible arrangements with repetition. So next, let's look at the case of arrangements without repetition. That's slightly more difficult. In this case, the goal is to find the number of possible orderings of k blocks again, but this time you choose those k blocks from a set of n blocks with different colors. So, which means that indeed we don't have repetition because we cannot reuse the same color. So, I rewrote what we want to do here. We want to find the total number of orderings of k blocks from a set of n distinct blocks. Same story as before. For the first block, you have n possible choices. So, we start with an n. That's the total number of possible ways you can choose your first block of the sequence. But you see that now, because there is no repetition, you already use one of those n blocks. For the second block, that must be of different color, you can only choose from a set of n minus one blocks. Okay, so you have n minus one then, that's the total number of possible choices for the second block. For the third one, you keep decreasing, you have n minus two possibilities, and so on. And you want basically a product of k turns. At each step, you decrease by one because you have one less block from your set of n blocks here. And so you should stop at n minus k plus one. Okay, so that's exactly the total number of possible orderings of k blocks chosen from a set of n distinct blocks. In this case, you can simplify this product. You see that if I keep going and multiply this by n minus k minus 1, and so on up to 1, basically I'm multiplying this expression by n minus k factorial. Eventually, I end up with the product n minus 1, n minus 2, down to 1, which is n factorial. And so that means that this can be simplified. You can write it in a compact form, and it's equal to n factorial divided by n minus k factorial. So that number, n factorial divided by n minus k factorial, is the total number of possible arrangements without repetition. So now let's look at the case of permutation without repetition. In this case, the goal is to find the total number of possible orderings of n distinct blocks. So it turns out that this case is not very difficult to compute now that we know the previous one. It turns out that the number of possible permutation without repetition is a particular case of arrangement without repetition. Indeed, this number of ordering is the same as the number of ordering of n blocks chosen from a set of n distinct blocks. So one way to get the number of possible permutation without repetition is to take k equals n in the previous expression, and that's going to give you n times n minus 1 times n minus 2, and you have to go up to n minus n plus 1, that's 1. And so eventually the product simplifies and you get just n factorial. Now, you can also get this total number of possible ordering without using the previous formula, but using the same reasoning as before, and you just say that because we start with n distinct blocks, n blocks with different colors. For the first block in the row, you have n possibilities. Then for the second one, you can only choose from the remaining n minus 1 blocks. So that gives you n minus 1 possibilities for the second one, and then n minus 2 for the third block, and so on. And once you have extracted n minus 1 blocks, like the first n minus 1 blocks, then you have only one possibility for the last one. And so indeed that gives you the product 1 times 2 times 3 up to n, which simplifies into n factorial. So conclusion, the total number of possible permutation without repetition is equal to n factorial. So now let's look at the case of combination without repetition. So here things become a little bit tricky. The goal is to find the number of possible subsets of k blocks chosen from a set of n distinct blocks or n blocks with different colors. So the goal is to compute this, and here you see that the number of subset of k blocks from a set of n blocks is closely related, I would say, to the number of orderings of k blocks from a set of n distinct blocks. The only difference is that in this case, the order in which you take the elements is not important, while here the order is important. So the idea to find this number of combinations without repetition it's to use this formula that we solved before. So for that, let me call x, for instance, or unknown. X is going to be, again, number of subsets of k blocks chosen from a set of n distinct blocks. And let's recount, but using a different technique, the number of possible arrangements without repetition, which is the case here. So if you want to count the number of possible ordering of k blocks from a set of n blocks, then we get exactly this n factorial divided by n minus k factorial. And the way we proceed to get this expression, it's by choosing the blocks sequentially. So that means that you start with your set of n distinct blocks. You are going to choose one that gives you n possibilities. Then you choose a second one. You have n minus one possibilities and so on. Up to block number k, you have n minus k plus one possibilities. So that's where this expression came from. And you see, so to compute this, we proceed sequentially by choosing the blocks one by one in a specific order. Another way to count the total number of possible orderings of k blocks from a set of n distinct blocks is to take k blocks from this set of n simultaneously, and the order does not matter, and then we need to order them. Okay? So, and so to do this, what you are going to do is say that, so this number is also equal. Now I'm going to recompute this number of ordering, but using a different approach. But then eventually the two numbers we get should be equal. So the first step you can do is choose k blocks from this set of n blocks simultaneously. And so by definition of x, you have x possible ways to do that. So you have x possible outcomes. But then here you end up with a set of k blocks where the order is not important. But now to create your ordering, you still need to order those k blocks that you extracted. And so for that, I'm going to use this n factorial that we found before. number of ordering of n distant blocks is n factorial. Now, what we extracted after doing those x possible, like x possible subsets of k blocks, we still need to look at the total number of possible orderings of that. And you must have, because you have k blocks, you must have k factorial possible orderings. Okay? So this times k factorial. So again, let me neuralize this. If I recap a little bit, what we have here on the board, at the top of the board, in this expression, what we have here is the total number of possible arrangements with out repetition if we proceed, let's say, sequentially. While here, what we do is compute the same number, but if we proceed by choosing the block simultaneously, and then ordering them. So now, of course, because what we do to compute this expression and this one are the same combinatorial operation, eventually those two numbers should be equal, which means that our unknown x, the number we are looking for, is just equal, x is going to be equal to exactly n factorial divided by n minus k factorial times k factorial. So we get eventually this expression, n factorial divided by n minus k factorial times k factorial. So conclusion, the number of combination without repetition is indeed equal to n factorial divided by n minus k factorial times k factorial. And the notation we use for this expression is this big parenthesis nk that we read n choose k. So this n choose k is something that we are going to use a lot after to solve primes in probability theory. Now let's look at the case of permutation with repetition. In this case, exactly like for permutation without repetition, the goal is to find the total number of possible orderings of n blocks, except that now those n blocks are not all distant, they are partitioned into k different subsets corresponding to k different colors, and we are going to call ni the number of blocks with color I. So in this case, we cannot compute this number of orderings by proceeding sequentially, meaning choosing one block for to be the first one in the row, and then the second block to be the second one, and so on. We are going to run into trouble if we do that. I'm going to show you why. Instead, the idea is to think that we have n distinct positions, and we are going to choose step one, n one position for all the blocks with color one, and then n two of the remaining positions for the blocks with color two, and so on. So instead of proceeding sequentially one by one for each block, we are going to again proceed sequentially, but for each color, and at each step we are going to choose simultaneously positions for those blocks. So let me draw a picture to explain that. So basically we have, let's say, a row like that corresponding to the positions of the blocks going from position 1 to position n. Now let's see why indeed if we proceed sequentially block by block we are going to run into trouble. Well, for the first block you have k possibilities because there are k different colors. Okay, so that's fine for the first block, we know that we have k possibilities. But already for the second block, in case the color you choose for the first position has only one representant here, if there is only one block of this color, then you have only k minus one possibilities for the second block. But if you chose at the first place a color with more than two blocks of this color, then you again have k possibilities for the second block. So already from the beginning, we don't know how to count things. So that's not the correct way to proceed. Instead, what we are going to do is step one, choose N1 positions for blocks with color one, assuming that color one is blue, let's say, and that we have N1 equals three blocks with color one, then you choose three positions and you put your blue blocks here. So let's say something like that, okay? Then step two, out of the 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 remaining positions, you are going to choose, let's say two, if you have two green blocks, for like blocks that are green. And so let's say, for instance, here and here. And then let's say that you have four red blocks. There are 1, 2, 3, 4 positions remaining. You put your red blocks here. So that's the way we proceed. Instead of putting the blocks one by one on this row, in which case counting already, like the second step might be difficult. Instead, what we do is that we put all the color, all the blocks with color one simultaneously by choosing N1 position out of the N positions, and same for color two and so on. So now let's write explicitly the number of possible ways we can do that at each step. So for the first step, we want to choose N1 position from the N position. So by definition, this number of possible ways is N choose N1. Number of possible choices of N1 distinct position from a set of N distinct positions. Then for step two, you have to be careful that because we already chose N1 position, there are N minus N1 remaining positions for the blocks with color two. And so that gives you total number of ways you can place blocks with color two after the ones with color one are placed is going to be exactly N minus N1 choose N2 and so on. And then you have N minus N1 minus N2 remaining positions for block with color three after you put color one and color two, and you have to choose N3 of those positions and so on. And you go up to N minus N1 and then minus NK minus 1, choose NK. So now this looks a little bit complicated, but in fact this expression simplifies a lot. And so to simplify this expression, I just quickly remind you that we just proved before that if you have a set of N distinct elements, now that this set of N distinct elements is going to play the role of the N distinct position. So the number of ways you can extract a subset of size K from this set is going to be equal to N choose K. So that's this expression that we find here always. And we just proved that N choose K, number of subset of a number of subset of size K of a set with N elements is equal to N factorial divided by N minus K factorial times K factorial. So now if you use this expression here to expand this product here, what you are going to find is that this is equal to N factorial divided by N minus N1 factorial times N1 factorial. Then for this second term, you get some N minus N1 factorial divided by this minus this factorial, that's N minus N1 minus N2 factorial times N2 factorials, and so on. And you see already that here you have a simplification. This N minus N1 factorial appears here and here, so you can simplify that. You see also that from this third term, you are going to have some N minus N1 minus N2 factorial that appears here also, so this simplifies and so on. And if you expand this, you can easily prove that in fact you get exactly N factorial divided by N1 factorial times N2 factorial times N3 factorials and so on. And so conclusion, using combination, this formula for combination without repetition, But again, instead of putting your blocks sequentially on the line, you are going to put each color simultaneously, and you use the expression for combination without repetition. You conclude that the total number of ordering here is equal to n factorial divided by n1 factorial, n2 factorial, up to nk factorial. So conclusion, going back to the slide, number of possible permutations with repetition of those n1 plus n2 plus nk blocks is equal to n factorial divided by the product of the ni factorial. Finally, let's look at the case of combination with repetition. That's the most difficult case. And now what we want to do is count the number of possible subsets of k blocks such that each of these blocks can be of n different colors. So counting the number of such subsets is a little bit tricky. I'm going to start with a proof, giving you some elements of the proof. And you will understand after why I'm going in this direction. So the first step is to call xi, the total number of blocks from this set of k blocks. Xi is going to be the number of blocks with color I. Blocks with color I. Of course, in this case, I can be anything from 1 to n because we have n different colors. And so the first step is to observe that the number of subsets of k blocks such that, again, each of those k blocks can be of n different colors is exactly equal to the number of possible solutions of some equations, so number of solutions of the equation that says that x1 plus x2 up to xn is equal to k. So what is that? Well, first, you see that indeed, because we have a total of k blocks, the number of blocks with color 1 and the number of blocks with color 2 up to number of blocks of color n should add up to the total number of blocks in our subset. So indeed, the sum should be equal to k. To see that the number of subsets here is indeed equal to the number of solutions, you need also to observe that if you change your solution, then you are going to change your subset, and vice versa. So it turns out that there is indeed a one-to-one correspondence between all the possible subsets of k-blocks, such that each block can be of n different colors, and the set of solutions of this equation. Now, it turns out that of course, you have also an extra condition that I didn't precise here, is like those xi are not real numbers. For instance, they must be integer that corresponds to a number of blocks. And so we have the condition that the xi are non-negative integers. So with xi in some set 0, 1, 2, and so on. Now, it's not obvious now at this point, but it turns out that counting the number of solutions of this equation is a little bit tricky if those xi can be equal to zero. So to avoid the problem, what I'm going to do is introduce new variables that I'm going to call xi bar. And xi bar is going to be equal to xi plus 1. And that's going to give us a new equation. Again, we have a one-to-one correspondence between those xi and xi bar. And so again, the number of subsets is going to be equal to the number of possible solutions of a new equation involving those xi bar. So the way it goes is as follows. So now let's introduce xi bar equals xi plus 1. Then now the number of solutions here is also equal to the number of solutions of a new equation, solutions of a new equation x bar 1 plus x bar 2 up to x bar n equals. So in this case, you see that because xi is equal to xi bar is equal to xi plus 1, here the sum becomes x1 plus 1 plus x2 plus 1 plus x3 plus 1 up to xn plus 1. And so you end up again with the sum of the xi, but you add 1 for each of the n variable. So eventually you have sum of the xi equals k plus 1 plus 1 plus 1 plus 1 n times, that's n. So eventually the sum here is equal to n plus k. Okay, but now you have the new condition that instead of having those variables in this set, now they are in the set 1, 2, 3, and so on. So I'm going to add this condition here. So with the new condition that x bar I is in the set 1, 2, 3, and so on. So these are strictly positive integers. So now it turns out that the number of solutions of this equation is not very difficult to compute, but there is, to do that, we need to use some kind of visual trick. And again, the visual trick works only if those variables are strictly positive. And so here is the trick. You just draw a line like this with n plus k dots. So you are going to have dots like that. Let's assume you have n plus k of them, so from 1 to n plus k. Now, if you have a solution of this equation, x bar 1, x bar 2, up to x bar n, I'm going to visualize this solution by doing the following. I'm going to say that, for instance, if x bar 1 is equal to 2, then I'm going to say that I'm taking a block of size 2 here. I'm going to put a bar here. Then maybe x bar 2 is equal to 3. And then I'm going to take the next 3 dots, put a bar here. This length here corresponds to x bar 2, so x bar 1 here. This is x bar 2, and maybe x bar 3, let's say we have only 3 colors and x bar 3 is equal to 3 again. So here I'm going to have x bar 3. Okay, so basically each time you have a solution of this equation, you can have some kind of graphical representation of this solution using this picture. And you see that again there is a one-to-one correspondence between the set of solution of this equation and the set of such pictures. I'm going to define what I mean by such picture. Now, you see that because we force those xi bar to be strictly positive, we indeed have, like, the number of blocks we have here is indeed equal to n, the number of colors. Dealing with the original xi, it's possible that some of the blocks here are empty, and so we have basically less than n blocks, and then that creates a problem to count the number of solutions. But here, because all of those xi bar are strictly positive, the number of possible blocks here is indeed equal to n. And you see that indeed, if you change your solution, you are going to change the size of those blocks and the position of those separation. And so that means that indeed, if you change the solution, you change the picture. If you change the picture, you change the solution. And in fact, there is a one-to-one correspondence between set of pictures and set of solutions. So now to conclude and to find the number of solutions of this equation, what we need to do is find the number of ways we can indeed find separations like that. And so for this, you see that because we have n blocks extracted from a set of n plus k dots, so I'm going to write a 1 here. That's block number 1, that's block number 2, and in general you go up to block number n. What you need to do is to have exactly n blocks, you need to choose n minus 1 separations like that. We need to have n minus 1 vertical lines, like those ones in the picture. And how many possible gaps do we have? Well, here we have 1, 2, 3 and so on. Well, in general, because you have n plus k dots, that gives you exactly n plus k minus 1 gaps between those dots. Okay? And so the number of ways you can choose and also to have n blocks, you need n minus 1 bars. And so conclusion, the number of such pictures that corresponds to the number of solutions of the equation that I wrote at the bottom, which is also equal to the number of subsets of k blocks where each of those blocks can be of n different colors, is exactly going to be equal to the number of ways you can choose n minus one of those n plus k minus one gaps. And so eventually conclusion, the number of subsets here is equal to n plus k minus one number of gaps. Here you have n plus k minus one of them. And you want to choose exactly n minus one separation to create your n blocks, corresponding to, again, the size of each block is going to be number of blocks of type I plus one. And so you need to do this, choose n minus one. So conclusion, the total number of possible combination with repetition, corresponding again to the number of subsets of k-blocks chosen where each of them can be of n different colors, is going to be equal to n plus k minus 1, choose n minus 1. If you expand this expression, you get n plus k minus 1 factorial divided by k factorial times n minus 1 factorial.